virtual country.
Yeah, right. Oh, absolutely. I'll take that.
Don't forget anything. It's actually a little bit of a long, long meeting. Okay, we're good. Let John get himself seated, get everybody into position. Okay, it is 4:00. We'll go ahead and call the April 13th, 2015 meeting to order with a roll call, please.
Mayor Householder.
Here.
Commissioner Blanchard.
Here.
Commissioner Crawford.
Here.
Commissioner Davis.
Here.
Commissioner Hardy.
Here.
At this moment, all who are able, would you please stand and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance in a moment of silence?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, thank you. This takes us to the awards and proclamations section of our meeting.
Item 3.1, the day of April 24th, 2015 as Arbor Day in the city of Salina. Sydney Soderberg, Tree Advisory Board Chairman, will read the proclamation.
Ms. Soderberg.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor and Commissioners. Whereas in 1872, J. Sterling Morton proposed to the Nebraska Board of Agriculture that a special day be set aside for the planting of trees. And whereas this holiday, called Arbor Day, was first observed with the planting of more than a million trees in Nebraska. And Arbor Day is now observed throughout the nation and the world. And whereas trees reduce the erosion of our precious topsoil by wind and water, cut heating and cooling costs, moderate the temperature, clean the air, produce oxygen, and provide habitat for wildlife. And whereas trees are a renewable resource giving us paper, wood for our homes, fuel for our fires, and countless other wood products. And whereas trees in our city increase property values, enhance the economic vitality of business areas, and beautify our community. And whereas trees, wherever they are planted, are a source of joy and spiritual renewal. And whereas Salina has been recognized as a Tree City USA by the National Arbor Day Foundation and desires to continue its tree planting practices, now therefore Aaron Householder, Mayor of the City of Salina, does hereby proclaim April 24th, 2015 as Arbor Day in the City of Salina and urges all citizens to celebrate Arbor Day and to support efforts to protect our trees and woodlands, and further urges all citizens to plant trees to gladden the heart and promote the well-being of this and future generations. Thank you.
Great. What events do you have planned?
We will be planting at least one tree at Oakdale School, hoping to replace the three trees in front of Oakdale School that will be removed for the Iron Street project. And if I could take just a minute to add, this is the 25th year that Salina will celebrate as a Tree City USA. And just as you are, we're concerned about budget. And I thought it might be interesting for you to know or to remind yourselves that Salina has a budget, a tree budget, or something of a tree budget, of $188,643. Last year, we planted 53 trees. Emporia has a $185,000 budget. Manhattan has a $318,000 budget, planted 200 trees last year. Hutchinson has a $233,000 budget, planted 82 trees. McPherson, my hometown, a fourth the size of Salina, has a $170,000 budget, planted 300 trees last year. And Lawrence has been a tree city for 37 years, has a $1,461,000 budget, and planted 942 trees last year. So we have a ways to go.
It's a lot of wood.
Thank you.
I've got your signed copy up here. I know this is something that's been important to you since our days on the Planning Commission. I used to rib you about everything has to have a tree, but there's an important reason for it, so I appreciate it. This will move us on to our citizens forum. This is an opportunity for anyone to bring anything they would like before the city commission that is not on today's agenda. Feel free to come up, just give your name and address, and we'd ask that you try and keep it around under 5 minutes. I gotta be careful saying around. No need to filibuster.
Judy Larson, 715 North 9th. First of all, I haven't been up here in a while, and I want to thank all of you for your prayers and support over the past few months when it's been kind of difficult. But I really appreciate, and I've been aware of all your support, and thank you very much. Secondly, I think it's an abysmal, a lousy reflection on Salina that so few people care about voting that the election has to be decided by a coin toss. And we've got to fix that. This is a much bigger deal than even the Super Bowl. You know, my friends in baseball decided against coin tossing because it just wasn't a good idea. And I wish other people would have that level of intelligence and caring. So thank you very much.
Great, thank you. It is important. We were thinking maybe a boxing match. Is that? Are you fit, Randall?
No comment.
Norman Mantle, West Pleasant Hill Road. Is the city aware that this weekend there was a firm outselling drug-related paraphernalia at the Bicentennial Center? Are they exempt from city regulations? There was supposed to be them, what do you call them, hookah pipes? I don't know about this drug stuff. I ain't got time for it. But why were they allowed to do this if they were?
I wasn't aware. I don't have anyone else.
We would probably have to ask, but rest assured, no one came to ask for a permit for it.
Well,
I've heard of it. I honestly don't have an answer.
I've heard this from other people too. So.
I don't know when we can maybe ask the city manager if he's aware of anything.
Well, I think he's referring to there's the liquidators. You see the commercial, the commercials on, they liquidate. There's all kinds of different products. Whenever that happens, we don't go search everybody's inventory. So unless we would have received a complaint about an illegal item, we wouldn't have had a reason to follow up.
Right.
So without speaking to the police department, I don't know if they did receive a complaint, and so I don't know if there was any follow-up at all.
Was that the sign I saw? I know as I was coming down the midway today for Rotary, there was a sign about some like stereo equipment or something. Is that what was going on? Or?
I assume so. It was a three-day sale.
Oh, okay.
Over the weekend,
okay.
So it may have been a sign left over.
So you're saying that there may have been hookah pipes or something being sold, which I don't think in itself is necessarily illegal, is it at all?
That's a good question. I was trying to recall because when we talked about the vapor bars, we also talked about the hookah bars, and the Planning Commission, City Commission chose not to legalize the hookah bars. I don't know that we prevented anyone from selling the product.
Right.
We typically don't go down that road except very significant situations. So I'd have to look. I can't say for sure, but I'm kind of leaning on the side that says I don't believe we said you couldn't sell the product.
Right.
It's just you can't use the product in a bar situation.
Right.
In town.
It was more of
but
a zone.
On your own, I believe on right. your own, it's perfectly legal.
Yeah, I think it is. Yeah.
Recollection.
Well, if you do find out, Jason, I mean, that would kind of clarify if somebody wants to, they let this business sell here for this weekend, so maybe the city's going to allow us to sell it for business now. We want a business to move into town, so we'll move this business in.
Yeah, I don't think it had anything to do with the actual pipe itself. I think our whole reason the zoning is the material, I think, was kind of where we set up, wasn't it? I don't know that even opening a shop that merely sells, I believe, in fact, the gas station on Iron Street, I think, sells it all. I don't think the material itself is the problem so much as the product that goes into it, I think, was
right.
What we were.
I think that's correct, because I believe we looked at it. It's different from, but I think we looked at it in the same way, for example, as smoking. You can't have, indoor smoking is not permitted in practically any indoor setting in Salina, but it doesn't mean that you can't, if you're of age to buy the product and smoke, you can smoke outside in your home, wherever.
Sure.
And so, of course, we don't ban the product, and I believe our focus was on the hookah bar, not necessarily whether someone individually can do that or not, because our focus was more, quite honestly, there's a, well, I remember when we talked about it, the material that's burned in there wasn't necessarily illegal from the perspective of being a drug, presuming that people would have followed the rules. It was more of a question of at what point do you cross over and you're into a smoking type situation. That was one issue based on the, I don't want to get into all the details of how those things work, but based on that, also presumption of certain health concerns that I think maybe needed to be vetted through the FDA first.
Right.
So based on all that, we decided not to permit a hookah bar, but I don't think we in any way prevented anyone from individually from doing that. There's in and of itself, there's nothing wrong with it.
Right. So
as we've spoken, I've reviewed the code, and that is a correct description of the definition of an electronic cigarette establishment and a hookah establishment focuses on use and primary concentration on sale. Incidental retail sales are permitted.
There.
So that being said, that wouldn't have been illegal for them to sell that merchandise.
I just wanted to answer to a question. I didn't need a conversation.
That's how we get there.
My recollection isn't what it used to be.
Yeah. Okay. Anybody else have anything they want to bring up before the city commission today at all? If not, we'll move into the regular part of the meeting. Okay. We'll close out the citizens forum and move on. We have no public hearings and I am scheduled for a certain time, so we'll move on to the consent agenda.
Item 6.1, approve the minutes of April 6, 2015. Item 6.2, approve change order number 1 for the sanitary sewer cleaning and inspection project number 14-3044 to Mayor Specialty Services LLC in the amount of $59,733.
Is there any item on the consent agenda a commissioner would like to remove or amend? If not, I'd entertain a motion to accept it as presented.
I move we approve the consent agenda.
Second.
Motion and second to approve the consent agenda as presented. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? That motion carries 5-0, and that'll take us on to administration.
Item 7.1, second reading ordinance number 15-10768, amending Salina Code section 31-1002 relating to the notice period of abatement of tall grass and weed nuisances by the City of Salina.
Ordinance number 15-10768 was passed on first read on April 6, 2015. Since that time, no comments have been received. Is there anyone from the public here to discuss this matter or have any issues with it? Okay, I'll bring it back to the commission for possible action.
Mr. Mayor, I move that we approve second reading ordinance number 15-10768, amending Salina Code section 31-1002 relating to the notice period of abatement of tall grass and weed nuisances by the City of Salina.
Second.
Motion and a second to approve ordinance number 15-10768 on second reading. Any further discussion? If I could get a roll call, please.
Commissioner Blanchard.
Aye.
Commissioner Crawford.
Aye.
Commissioner Davis.
Aye.
Commissioner Hardy.
Here.
Mayor Householder.
Aye.
Aye.
That's a routine. That motion carries 5-0.
Item 7.2, authorize staff to submit an application on behalf of eligible local agencies for the 2015 Kansas Emergency Solutions Grant Program.
Mr. Hobby.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Mayor and Commissioners, we bring for you today a request on behalf of four different agencies from the City of Salina to apply for an emergency shelter grant program. This year, we happened to reach out to the majority of all the agencies or not-for-profits within the community that we felt like could assist us in actually bolstering our application this year and increasing our numbers as well as the usage within our community. This year we happened to be able to reach out to Catholic Charities as well as the Food Bank, and we have an application this year of four different agencies that we're very pleased to be able to submit on their behalf. The contract period is from July 1st, 2015 through June 30th of 2016. This used to be the emergency shelter grant program, but they have changed modifications again this year and added an area called street outreach, which I think is very interesting, and it's also something that Catholic Charities would like to reach out and do this year, and we're very interested in seeing how they can provide services to unsheltered homeless people within our community. We feel like there's a need out there that maybe is being unmet. Sue Klein is our development services supervisor, and we ask her to reach out to all the agencies within our community, and four of them got together And they collaborated very well this year and very pleased with the program that we've had and we'll be able to offer in the community. This year we're applying for $291,490, which is about 1.5 times what we've requested in the last few years. And we feel like we have a pretty good chance of working with that. Mr. James Chisholm from the Kansas Housing Resources Corporation reached out to us 2 years ago. We actually were able to amend our grant and work with some reallocation of funds. And he asked us then this year to go back and look at that reallocation and say, who can use these funds the best within your community and maybe have different applicants apply for different monies. So we did that, and Sue did a great job of working with them. They met about 3 or 4 times, and the agencies met together and decided which area, which program would best fit which agency. And that is put before you today of a $291,000 grant we feel like is very profitable for our community in the future. Staff would recommend that you approve us or recommend submitting the grant application for emergency shelter grant for the fiscal year 2015. I'd be more than glad to stand for any questions.
Great, thank you. Any questions for staff?
Is this approved or denied en bloc, or is it possible that a lower amount of funding would be received?
Yes, we usually apply for a larger amount than what we actually end up getting, depending on what Mr. Chisholm and the group in Topeka actually sets for each one of our communities. The last couple of years, we've received a little over half of what we had asked for. This year, we feel like we've really put a little extra effort and strength into the program, and hopefully we will not see much of any reduction at all. When we do receive that reduction from the state of Kansas, if we do, then we'll come back to you and let you know what the allocation will be and how it's split up between each one of the agencies.
On this, I've got a quick question on this. I know last year when we looked at this, there was a little bit of a disappointment in that some of the agencies didn't make application because the paperwork was a little more than they felt was basically that it wasn't worth the effort. Is that
correct?
Were we able to help them out in a way this year that kind of got them past that point, or what's the difference between this year and last year with the application process?
I believe that we asked Mr. Chisholm to come in and do some education with our agencies. That helped by having about a 4-hour presentation by him explaining some of the reporting aspects of the program. The HMIS is probably the most difficult portion to do the reporting on. And with that help and Sue Klein's help of being able to coordinate all the groups together this year, I think made a difference in our application. So we think it'll be much more substantial this year than we have in the last couple of years.
Right. Well, I thank you guys for identifying the problem that we all felt we had and then taking constructive steps to getting the agencies educated and the help in getting those applications filled out, because that's a significant difference when we're looking at it, you know, all the needs that we have throughout the community and these types of outreach. So
exactly. Very, yeah. Very pleased that the food bank came back, as well as Catholic Charities came back into the program. We've asked them for the last few years to come back, and this year we finally, through the collaboration, been able to get them back into the program for a request.
All right.
So, thank you.
Great. Any other questions? All right. Anyone here from the public that want have anything to say on this issue, or any representatives from any of the candidates for these programs? If not, okay, I'll bring it back to the commission for possible action.
I move we authorize staff to submit an application on behalf of eligible local agencies for the 2015 Kansas Emergency Solutions Grant Program.
Second.
Motion is second to authorize staff to submit an application on behalf of eligible local agencies for the 2015 Kansas Emergency Solutions Grant Program. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? That motion carries 5-0.
Item 7.3, 2014 Special Assessment Projects. 7.3A, Certification of Final Costs for 2014 Special Assessment Projects, and set May 4th, 2015 as the date of public hearing. Item 7.3B, First Reading, Ordinance Number 15-10772.
Mr. Stack.
Thank you, Mayor and Commissioners. This item sets the basically sets the public hearing process for final assessment projects. These assessments are actually from a 2014 project, Magnolia Hills Estates, Phase 4. It was approved in the summer of 2013, actually, and completed last year around this time, and they decided to wait for another year to levy the special assessments. So the engineering staff, Wayne Nelson is here, has completed the review of all the costs. We've gotten them all checked and cleared through the bond council. This was a development agreement project, so the developer and with the development agreement has not actually been paid until the bonds are sold. So that'll happen once this process is complete and the bonds are sold, and the development agreement states that the developer will be reimbursed at that time, which will be sometime late this summer. Basically, this process starts notice for public hearing and levies the assessments at this, or gets ready to levy the assessments. So first reading of the ordinance, you guys got that later, I believe. You should have a copy of that at your desks. Is that right? Okay, thank you. And April 13th is today. May 4th is the public hearing and the second reading of the ordinance. June 15th is the date when the bonds will be authorized to be sold, and then bonds will be sold later this summer. So I don't see Rod here, but anyway, I can try to answer questions.
There he is.
He is back.
Without his beard, he's kind of hard to recognize.
He's shaving today, yeah.
He's all clean cut.
Money tie, I don't know. Okay, I'll stand for questions.
Any questions for staff on this at all?
Yeah, I've got a question on your calendar of events, and I went back and looked at some of the past special assessment calendars that we did. You did note on here that that what we're doing here today is to establish a hearing date, and then also first reading. And on the first reading, there is a note here that says that we could do this on the 20th or the 27th. And I do, in looking at the past actions that we've done these, we have typically done them on introduce 1 week, first reading, and the following week, a second reading. Is there any reason why we could not put this first reading off until the 27th?
I don't believe so.
Okay.
We typically have always, looking at the past blue sheets that we've done on this every year, we certify the costs and we set the public hearing date, and then we typically read the ordinance. This is a standard, but it looks like you don't have to do that. It could be read at a different date. And yes, the calendar clearly says that. So okay. Bond council thought that would be fine.
Okay. I don't really see any difficulty in that doing it. I don't think we're going to set the time back. I mean, if the whole date is set for May 4th and we can do a second reading on May 4th, and it doesn't seem to me that we'll have any, we won't be stopping the calendar or anything, but I just feel like since special assessments were a huge part of this past election, I think it would only be prudent that we allow the new commission to hear this item, because I can tell you that I certainly have a few things that I'd like to say in regard to special assessments, and I think that it would provide a perfect opportunity to have a discussion at that time and do the first reading on the 27th of April. So, is there any reason staff sees that that wouldn't be?
Unless there's a specific time frame between the first reading and second, and I'm not aware of any, there wouldn't be a reason we couldn't do this. And again, as Dan mentioned, the bond council left the date open for you for that, so they should have looked at that, and they're very thorough, so I would expect they have already addressed that.
Great.
Dan, I had a quick question. You mentioned waited a year. Are you talking about waiting a year for the developer to actually put in the infrastructure? No, they completed the infrastructure last year around this time, so it would have been a rush to try to get it on the last year's assessments, and they decided to wait. I guess that's all I'm saying, is they started it, finished it up about a year ago. Is that fair to say, Wayne?
Yeah, actually,
April of last year. And so it was close. We thought they'd probably want to get paid last year.
Actually, as I recall, last year they finished it. It was a little later than this, And when we talked to the developer at that time, he did not want to, he basically wanted to hold it another year rather than try to rush it through.
Well, so. Okay, but when we say rush it through, what I'm looking at is the how that decision equates to the time frame at which we should have started it if we wanted to start collecting assessments in the last year, over the last year. Once we get this process finished, you get the bond sale date, you get the second reading of the bond ordinance, does this affect when we actually start collecting special assessments?
We'll start collecting them this fall.
Okay, so they'll still match up with the bond
sure.
issuance. Okay,
yeah.
That's fine then.
I would just add that the development agreement that the city has executed with the developer had specific dates that they had to submit their invoicing to meet the schedule for the sale of the bonds. They did not meet that initial deadline, so it had to go over to this year.
Okay, thank you.
One other question. If the first reading was pushed back, does that affect any obligation to mail notices of the hearing or publish in the paper? Is there enough time before the public hearing?
I believe so. It was my understanding we certify the costs and we set the date. Do we have to wait to mail the notices until the reading is read? Is that as far as you know, Shandy or Rod?
No.
Notification can happen immediately then.
Okay.
All right.
Okay. Since it was published today, I mean, we'll look into this potentially a motion, but since it was in today's agenda, we should check and see if there's anyone from the public who came to speak on this issue at all. If not, we'll bring it back to the commission. Okay, seeing nobody out there, maybe we'll bring it back. So, John, are you thinking, Commissioner Blanchard, mm-hmm. are you thinking putting this off to the 27th then? Or?
No, I would. Let me just ask staff, Mr. Gage or Bengtson, what's the, can we set the date? That's not part of the ordinance, correct? Setting the date?
Correct.
Okay. So if a motion were made to set a meeting for May 4th, 2015 as a date of a public hearing for the certification of final cost for the 2014 special assessment project?
Yes.
Okay, so moved.
Second.
Okay, so motion and a second to, you're saying ordinance 15-1072, sorry.
No. I'll withdraw, setting
the date?
I'll withdraw them.
Yes.
Okay.
May 4th, 2015.
Mayor, if I may ask a quick question, possibly of Commissioner Blanchard, are we anticipating probably formally postponing consideration of the first reading as a subsequent motion?
Yes.
Okay. To the 4th or to the 27th, as you discussed?
To May 4th. Well, the motion is for the certification of the final cost.
To take place on the 4th?
For that public meeting to take place on the 4th of May, 2015. Setting that date as a meeting.
Set that as the assessment hearing date then?
Yes.
Okay. I thought we were shooting on the 27th. That's what I was looking
Well, no. Well,
so May 4th is where you're wanting to?
Right.
That's
we'll
your motion?
Set, okay.
So motion and second from Commissioner Hardy to set the assessment hearing date and first reading of the assessment ordinance to May 4th, 2015.
No.
We have to read the ordinance before that. So
well, that's why I thought we were the 27th. I'm sorry.
Well, right. No.
First reading of the ordinance will have to be the week before.
Right.
So you need to set the date. And can we certify
the cost? We're just setting the date for.
Certify the cost and set the date. Letter A on the item, is that what we could do today? And that mm-hmm. that could be the right. motion. And the second part, you could just delay till the 27th.
That looks right.
But that's what it says to May 4th, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but we're not going to read the ordinance
okay.
first time on the 4th.
Okay, no. So set the certification of final cost for the 2014 special assessments project and setting May 4th as the date of the public hearing.
There you go. Right.
Yes.
Okay, right. Yeah. Sorry, we kept talking 27th. I was getting a little confused as to what date, what needs to be read. Okay, So that motion is second then to for certification, setting the date for the certification of final cost for 2014 special assessments projects, and setting May 4th, 2015 as date of public hearing. Any further discussion on that? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? That motion carries 5-0.
And then, if I may, Mr. Mayor, I'd move that we postpone the first reading, ordinance number 15-10772, levying special assessments for improvement, to Monday, April 27th, 2015.
Second.
Okay. Motion and second to postpone the first reading of ordinance number 15-10772, levying special assessments for improvements, to Monday, April 27th, 2015. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? That motion carries 5-0.
Item 7.4, award the project to reconstruct Iron Avenue from Front Street to Delaware Avenue, city project number 13-3008.
Mr. Stack.
Thank you, Mayor and Commissioners. This project has quite a bit of history, as you know. Most of you all know, so we're glad to bring this to you today. Finally did get the bids received on April 7th, so last Tuesday we opened the bids on this project. I can go through the background, I guess. We've gone through a lot of iterations of this project. Originally started as definitely the pavement is in sorry condition and needs to be replaced, but then we ended up adding some other amenities to the project, and now we are also, one thing to note is we had to add a water line. I know that was discussed early on, and utilities thought, well, it's an old water line, but it's still it was in decent shape, hadn't had a lot of breaks on it, but after further review of that water line, they did some work to fix some valves, and once they started getting into the water line, they felt like, okay, it's really probably worth replacing when you're putting in the road, especially with the colored stamped concrete. It's hard to match if there is a break. So all those things kind of led to adding that to the project. So that's just something to note and why that got added in here. Martha can explain it further if Ms. Tasker could explain it further if we need to. We did ask for the contractor to bid a few alternates. Mike Frazier, former public works director, has had some experience with the stamped and colored concrete, and he just said it's really hard to match, so we thought, well, we could at least ask for a bid on the using the bricks. We have a lot of bricks in the city, and actually a lot of our contractors have a lot of bricks, and we have a lot of bricks, so we thought, okay, we can at least see what that might cost. So that was why we had a couple options here. Pavers was the low bidder, and they were with the stamped and colored concrete, they were the low bidder. Smoky Hill actually did have a little bit lower bid for clay for the using the bricks, but they were higher than pavers overall, so that's why we've looked at pavers as the low bidder for the stamped and colored concrete portion. It was about 5.5% higher than the engineer's estimate, which was unfortunate. And it was we tried to look back and see, okay, what were the things that were, you know, a lot different. We found a few things that are a little more than we originally thought. Concrete's a little pricier this year. We don't know if that's a kind of a trend or more just the project is broken up into phases and they can't maybe get as much production. So I don't know exactly why that is, but that was one of the items that was concrete was a little bit more on this project. Excavation, the contractor's also proposing some subgrade stabilization was something that was a little different as well. And I don't know, just in general, just costs we were just off by a little bit. So I guess we were felt like that it's still a quality bid, very close, pretty tight bids, good contractors here in Salina. And we felt like we should still try to go with this project. One thing to note, on the project is that we do have a year-long time frame on this. It's a massive project, really. It's almost $3 million worth of work. The wire line adds some time as well. It would have been nice maybe to have gotten it started earlier. It would have been tight, but to get it done in a season, but we feel like it, giving them time into next year helps. They do want to start in front of the school this summer, so that'll at least get that going. Now, that was a sticking point also with the contractors, as they didn't feel like they could get it all done in front of the school. in time for school to start. So we put some provisions in there to make sure there was access and pedestrian crossing access for people who walk to school from the south side of the road, so they can get across. Most of the access to the school actually happens from the Johnstown side or the Penn side, I believe. So we don't really shut off access. We do impact the school. So the hope is we can get that done, the majority of it done this summer, and not stretch it into the fall. But then there's a couple other phases as well. Of course, the one east of Ohio, and then the other, the area in front of Taco Bell. Taco Bell's actually closed for reconstruction right now as well. So they were kind of happy for the project because they were actually redoing their building there at the corner of Ohio and Crawford. So just some things to note with the phasing. But I guess our fiscal note as well, we were able to, we know that the budget is tight, and budget was amended with the sub-CIP or the CIP just recently. Rod updated it for the 2015-2019 CIP to $2.8 million. It had about $2.2 million of GO bonds. $562,000 were estimated for the federal fund exchange. We went back and looked at our federal fund exchange dollars, and we know we've gotten more money over the years than we've spent. We did spend the amount that we were allocated to spend on East Magnolia, but we also had some savings on the project that we didn't spend as much as we thought we would, and we estimated around $400,000 to $400,000, it seemed like, per year early on, and we've consistently got almost $500,000. So over the last few years, that's added up, and we feel like that would be a good use of the dollars for the 2014-2015 federal fund exchange dollars, and that would take care of the overages here, which really is the $100,000+ we were under on our estimate, as well as some contingency, some construction engineering, and then as well as a gateway feature, which you all have talked about some over the past few months. That could all fit into that with a little room to spare, even with using the federal fund exchange dollars. So, and then the federal fund exchange dollars are pretty flexible, so we just use those on a different project if we don't use them all. So the hope is that we could not use them all, but anyway, they do exist to fund the project. Waterline relocation is a separate item, and that actually is paid from the Water and Wastewater Funds Capital Improvement Reserve. City Manager asked us to look at some items possible for removal, and we struggled with trying to figure out, okay, what could you actually remove out of here that wouldn't impact it a whole lot. So we did find a few things. Street lighting from 4th to Front Street. The street lighting is fairly expensive, and it's a fairly long stretch from the 4th Street Bridge there to the railroad tracks approximately to Front Street, so it's a long run. So that was $150,000, so that could be deferred to a later date if that's something you're interested in. The gateway feature, of course, can be done anytime. It's not really connected with the project, but it can be done another time if necessary. The colored concrete median and the street signs were not a huge cost, but $25,000, and the colored concrete median wasn't a whole lot more, surprisingly, than got a pretty good price on. I mean, it was higher on the concrete, but the concrete median colored portion wasn't a significant, just for the one block, it just really wasn't a significant number. $44,000 was about all that was. So anyway, those were the three items that if you were to start and basically add them up, you could get to $2.84 million, which is close to the 2.8 if we wanted to eliminate some items or have us go back and look for any other things we should try to reduce. So Yeah, there is lighting in that section between Front and 4th Street now. It's just the wood poles, just the kind of the intersection lighting. Actually, the community theater has some pretty good lighting in front of it, so it's not a real, it's not just a dark area, but it's definitely the old style wood poles and intersection lighting that we have in that area. So that would, is that answering your question? We do have some lighting there. It would just be.
Commissioners, your direction initially as far as project amenities was recognizing that we took the downtown style lights mm-hmm. and we had them along the whole corridor was to fill that gap between Front and 4th Street mm-hmm. so that you have that continuous type of lighting all the way through.
Right.
So this would you take away those lights and just you'd have what you have right now. That's what would be left between Front and 4th Street.
Right.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's actually where they start. The new lighting starts there on the Iron Street Bridge.
When we're looking at the stamped and colored concrete and or the pavers, are the numbers that you have in here, do they reflect the median from Oakdale to Front plus all the crosswalks out to Ohio? Or are they separated anyway, crosswalks from that median?
I think that's what makes it. Are you talking about the?
Well, the mountable, when it says a mountable, there's two things. Bullet point
right.
two and three. Two right. is a mountable flush stamped and colored concrete median
mm-hmm.
from Front Street. And then then three is stamped and colored concrete crosswalks from Front Street to Ohio. So is the number reflect both of those, because I think we were always going with
the crosswalks,
but it seemed to have floated between from Ohio to the whole project with stamped medians, mountable ones, and then just went to that last section in the last time we discussed this. So, because I can tell you, I can do without the median mm-hmm. concrete. I like it at the crosswalks because I think it really helps to help identify those. And mm-hmm. then my only concern with the stamped, and you had mentioned it earlier, is that how often would we anticipate any sort of cuts in those that would go through those crosswalks and any repairs that would go in? Because it would seem to me that it might be less expensive in the long run to have the pavers in there, if you could take those out, do the work, and put the pavers back versus...
Yeah, the utility work would typically be what would cause you to cut into it. So I think replacing the water line is a big help to eliminate what would be potential. Well, the idea is, of course, as you know, to match up the life of the infrastructure so that you don't put a nice new street in and then 5 or 10 years later that street's still fairly new, fairly young in its life, and all of a sudden you have a water main break and you have to cut out a big section and all that. So I think the odds of what you're talking about happening go down quite a lot with the new water line through there.
And so when we go in and say we have to crack seal or do some micro surfacing down the road, does having those as stamped concrete versus something you might be able to go in and take out and do your mill and overlay or whatever, is there any difference in street maintenance of having pavers versus concrete down the road? No pun intended.
Well, the stamped concrete could crack, and mm-hmm. That's an interesting question as far as, Dan, this is probably a question for you, is when you have a colored concrete and you need to fill cracks, because it can crack just like other concrete, it just looks a little different on top.
Yeah, we have to maintain the cracks pretty similar, and typically the cracks are maintained by you route them or you cut them, and then you put the black material in them, and it's actually recessed, so you don't slobber it on top, basically. Not quite like our asphalt roads where it sits on top, but most of our concrete roads, you'll see it recessed a little bit. So that way you don't see black lines everywhere as much with the white concrete or the red concrete. But yeah, we'd still have to maintain the cracks as much. We do end up overlaying or microsurfacing concrete eventually, but right, not typically with our arterials. It's quite a ways down the road. It's a long ways.
Well, I mean, I just see a little bit of a cost savings by doing the stamp versus the clay bricks. I'm just concerned that we're not tripping over dollars picking up pennies.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And I think your real question is if we compared the two over the life of the street, mm-hmm. which gives us the lowest maintenance time
right.
materials
right.
and looks the best. And probably would be the, I would expect it would be the pavers would be the best option.
Right, the brick.
Yep. Usually what you see with pavers, you don't see the color fade out. If anything, if depending on how clean your street is, it might get a little dingy mm-hmm. in time. That's really about all you might see. But typically, that's a pretty low maintenance option. Again, if you're going to get into any kind of cuts, anything like that, you can remove them, put them back in. Mm-hmm. It's no big deal. You don't have to worry about cracking through them or anything like that. Right. So,
well, I know up in where I live, and I was hoping that's where you were going. I'm with you. I think that little strip of colored median seems wasteful compared to the rest of the street. And then I definitely feel like the brick not only adds to the heritage of that street and the history, but from a maintenance standpoint, I know up where when I go home on the brick streets, they replace something. You know, as soon as they're done, you couldn't tell they did anything. There's no cuts. There's just replaced bricks up there. So it seemed to me that the long term, that was maybe a better access point. And I think it looks a little classier, too. You know, I just think it looks a little better and lends itself more to that being a historic street in Salina.
I see the stamped concrete as being a poor option for brick. You're trying to simulate mm-hmm. brick by using right. the stamped concrete, and it's only a $58,000 difference. And I see over the lifetime, you know, the next 40, 50 years of the life of the pavement, that the $58,000 is going to pay, come back to us in other ways, I think.
And I would assume that number would be less if we're not filling in that space in the median area
right,
as well. So it won't even be that much there. That's going to reduce that cost as well. So, okay.
Commissioners, just to kind of summarize this piece, are you looking at the possibility of excluding the median but ensuring that the crosswalks have the pavers rather than the colored concrete?
Mm-hmm. That would be my position.
Right.
Okay.
And then just to wrap up my comments, I think that all along it, and I don't want to speak for the rest of you, you can, but I think that our feeling on the gateway was that if we could do it in a project neutral way, I think we would be open to doing that, and seeing that that doesn't look possible, I think that we would just want to eliminate the gateway portion of this.
If you do that, and this is totally up to you, you have a few options. For example, without spending a lot of money, we could still go down the road of concepts for gateways. It depends if you want, to go through the community art and design process or not. That's still maybe a question, but we could still do that without spending money and have a plan on the shelf that everybody likes that when the funding comes, which could be through your capital improvement planning to say, well, we're ready, let's look at the downtown locations and start putting in gateway pieces. Or if in sometime in the future, at least on the east side, if there's some renovations, redevelopment, if you have a river project, something like that, that's a good opportunity to say, now let's put in the gateways and meet the intent of the comp plan. So you really have opportunities in the future if you want to pull that today. But probably if you want to pull that today, the real question would be is, do you want us to continue to look at a concept or stop that part as well?
And once again, since I kind of brought the thing up a while back, I think that since gateways and entry corridors and everything else in general are a big part of the comp plan, I think that we can probably be best serving the intent of the plan to look at it in a more broad sense and make sure that if we do gateways throughout the community, that they somehow have some sort of cohesive look and feel to them, so that it's easily recognizable that these are gateways, that's the intent of these, and so on. So I'm not sure that having it specific for one location is probably going to be the best way to go forward on this.
Well, I think we could look at it with the perspective of again replication, which was
right.
part of the direction earlier, in the same way that we looked at the interstate signage and entryway gateway signage for those, could do the same thing and still go down the road of trying to look at a concept. That's just what I want to make sure, because mm-hmm. we wouldn't do that if you said, Jason, let's just not even look at that at this point in time because we're not ready to put this one in. But if you said, you know, we're not ready to put this one in, but we'd still like to look at the concept and make sure it can be replicated and so forth, we'll come back to you if there's any kind of serious money attached to that. But I really don't think there's a lot to focus on a concept. Right. But again, it depends the process you want to utilize and so forth.
Yeah.
right now.
Well, it can, but I really don't think that you're looking at that many.
If problems. A very simple design for a gateway, and it may be just something as simple as an interactive kiosk. I mean, something that you could duplicate all around town. Is there ready funding to pay for that?
Well, we don't know what it costs right now. That's what I say.
Very simple. It may just be a $5,000 kiosk. I don't know what kiosk costs, but
the footing's about $5,000. Yes.
Yeah. It doesn't. I don't think it'll cost. I'm going to speculate here and say I don't think it would cost more than that to come up with a basic concept that could be replicated in the downtown. I could be wrong, but if so, we could bring it back to you. I guess the question, though, is given that it should be fairly affordable, do you want us to continue looking at what a gateway could look like, gateway features replicated in the downtown could look like, or abandon that at this time?
I think that we can do that as part of what's moving forward with downtown already.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, so maybe just as it pertains to being consistent with that, maybe as we engage a downtown development group or groups and Slide Downtown Inc. and some other organizations and planning commission and so forth. I think that I'd certainly welcome that.
Okay.
I think it would also be important to make sure that the community art and design process is included in this decision.
I shy away from when we say the process. Because
yeah.
I think that's what got us. I certainly think that we need to it would be nice to be able to utilize talent and resources from the department if we can figure out a process that isn't so, I hate to use that process.
It doesn't cost us 20 grand is what you're saying.
Right. It's well,
yeah.
No, it's just that it allows some flexibility and more input from other groups, because what I was hearing is that, you know, what we went through last time was following the process, and yet I think that groups that we had expected would be part of the conversation weren't. So I don't want to say let's go through the process, but I would like to have that expertise or that I would like to have, and I think it was said before that we have artists and designers and so on that are in arts and humanities, and I think that they serve a very important place in this process, little P process. But the big P process just kind of makes me nervous that we're taking this and saying, okay, we want gateways here, go do gateways, and then when we get it back, we don't know what's coming. So I don't know if that makes sense, but
I think I can make it easy for you. If we incorporate this with the downtown initiative, of course, as you know, the first thing that has to happen there is the private dollars raised that locks in the construction of the field house. And then there's many steps with the rest of the initiative before we're talking about an actual project plan. In essence, you've gained quite a few months probably, which there's really no decision needs to be made on this. Kind of gets put aside. If we get to the first step of that and the field house can be constructed and other pieces of that downtown initiative occur, at that point we come back and look at that, because we'll be talking conceptually about Santa Fe design,
mm-hmm.
whatever we're doing on cross streets, transitions, probably arcades, things like that. This comes into play at that point in time.
Right.
So really what it does is it probably makes it a question for another day, and you don't really even have to deal with process
right.
today. That'll happen if this goes forward.
I'm fine pulling it out. And I the one thing that we also need to keep in mind that I think was maybe not so much last time is that the comprehensive plan specifies gateways, and it mentions five specifically, and they need to be uniform and across the board. So I think it falls more into a downtown redevelopment than maybe a street rebuilding. It was a nice concept, and I think it was actually Commissioner Blanchard's idea initially to even throw anything on here, and I think the idea was in the right place. I just don't think it kind of went kind of where we were wanting it to be, and maybe got a little more convoluted than we were hoping for. And obviously, I think we all agreed initially it was needing to be budget neutral, and it's obviously not. We're obviously over budget,
right.
So.
Yeah, I think that works fine.
I think it'll work better if we just look at the whole thing as a whole,
mm-hmm.
all okay. the entryways.
Right.
Agreed
for me.
And then we won't be kind of hodgepodge things together. That's my thought.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And then I think the one outstanding on mine was is that I like the lights between Oakdale and Front just because I think that that block, it kind of gives it a nice, and if we're not going to have a gateway there, it actually gives it another nice level of sense of arrival.
Yeah.
That you're
those
entering.
Those are staying on this.
Oh, okay. All right.
We only thought about removing outside the project limits, which is fourth to front.
Oh, yeah. No, no, no. Yeah.
Okay.
Fine with
so
that.
Yeah. The other ones, the Oakdale to front, those are in for sure. That's part of the project. But, you know, the outside the project is a little bit west of front there in front of the
yeah,
new.
Yeah. Your idea is to not have a gap there.
Yeah. Right. And you wanted to connect it, and that's a good point. It's just something we could do it later if you wanted, but it's right. We can do it now, too. It's probably fine.
Yeah.
Right. I'm fine with later because I think that there are some parcels there, especially on the south side of Iron, that have a great potential for redevelopment. So where that is, I think, and if that happens, then I think maybe.
One thing to consider, commissioners, is if it's just a timing question, if you say no matter what, we want those lights in the future, your lighting cost is probably going up and your interest rates may very well go up because interest rates are very, very low for issuing the debt. So if you know you're going to have it, I can't promise this, but you probably are getting your best deal on the lights now
right.
to get the same lights versus later. And as a matter of fact, I don't know, this is a question that we could ask the light vendor. They change styles a lot, you know, in various years. So if that falls in later, we might, you know, knock on the door and we find that we have a few extras just to replace if one gets hit by a car or something. But I don't know how long we should expect that particular model to be available either. So my thought is if you know for sure you want it filled, you make this project a little bit more expensive given the bids, but it's a cost today or it's a cost tomorrow. Mm-hmm. You can decide if you feel financially it might be better off to just do that today.
Okay. I'm good with them being in then.
Would the level of lighting, the lumens or whatever, be more than what we've got on our streets right now?
And it's designed similar to what the downtown design was. So for a collector in a certain width street, the bulbs have to be a certain lumens, and they have to cover.
I'm talking about the shorter ones, the LEDs.
Yeah, the ones downtown
yeah.
now.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it'd be similar to what's on. What is it? Iron Street now, west of 4th. So
yeah,
that's similar lighting. But if you look at all of our streets in town, they're all over the map on that.
Right,
so
but I mean the ones downtown, mm-hmm. I guess there's a question as to the level of brightness that's being emitted. And I was just
right.
wondering if this is something that can be changed in this upcoming project.
Yeah, the what seems to be working downtown is they've changed out to the next generation of lights. As those LEDs improve, a little bit more light can be put out with a little less wattage, and so it's just interesting how they've improved enough in the last 2 years to say that these will get the latest generation of lights, and so they're a little bit brighter with a little less energy cost, and that's what has been the fix for the downtown lights, basically on Iron Street anyway, is that the newer generation is what got us to that right lighting emission, light foot candle level.
Dan, do you know, is this area, this gap area we're looking at, was that included in the prior lighting analysis where we looked at the lighting deficiencies, or was it outside the area?
I thought that was outside the area.
That's a good question.
From the BWR report, you're saying?
Yeah. The BWR report, when we use that, the basic premise is if the lighting is sufficient and meets the standards for that environment, streets, so forth, whatever it might be, then you certainly don't want to go backwards. You would make sure that whatever your LED wattage is it provides sufficient lumens, as Dan mentioned, for that area. Mm-hmm. So you wouldn't go backwards in that way. And there are some areas that were already insufficient, and I don't know if this area is insufficient or not. If it's insufficient, it's brought up to the standard. It doesn't mm-hmm. stay insufficient. So you would be sure that it'll be sufficient for the lighting environment that you have. You certainly wouldn't continue an insufficient lighting situation there.
Okay, any other questions for staff? Okay, thank you, Mr. Stack.
Thank you.
Anyone here from the public care to comment on this matter at all? Oh, sure, Ms. Larson. We need to get you a handheld mic. Consider this part of your rehabilitation.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're noting this, Dr.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, Judy Larson, 715 North 9th. I was on Iron Street today, and the kids were running crazy, crossing the streets in the middle of the block and all kinds of stuff. So is this just kids being kids, or is it an indication that we don't have enough of those protected push-button crossings for the kids to use? And if that's the case, then maybe we should take advantage of this project to maybe improve that and improve the safety of the children.
Good question, yeah.
Well, the...
Between Oakdale and North and downtown.
If we're talking about the school, the crosswalk location, I believe, is adjusted, moved a little bit to take advantage of where they should cross. But on a road like Iron Street, you're probably talking about $80,000 to $100,000 a shot to put signalized, protected push button signals at various places, and you want to try to avoid having too many mid blocks.
Right.
Because what you're going to do is you're going to start creating traffic issues on the major street. And so you try to place those at the proper locations. And quite honestly, the school is the real draw that creates a crossing the street there. Now, you can't help whether kids decide to just cross over. You can't put enough for that in that situation. That's really a parental child issue where we can do some education for everybody, and they need to talk to their kids about when to cross the street and how to cross the street. But that's basic safety education between a parent and a child, and we'll help all we can. But we did adjust the location of the crosswalk for Oakdale to try to make sure that we're, because you build that stuff where they cross if you can, if you can do that without disrupting traffic. So that's really what we tried to do there. So I think we're in pretty good shape with that as it relates to the school. But beyond that, I don't think we would recommend placing any more along the way.
Yeah, makes sense. Good point. Mm-hmm. Anyone else? Okay, seeing none, I'll bring it back to the commission for possible action.
Mr. Gates, were you keeping score there?
I'm trying.
Okay.
I can summarize, but I don't have numbers by everything yet. So I was hoping Dan's calculator was pretty.
Okay. Would you care to summarize?
Sure. And then you can tell me if this is correct. But it looks like that you do want to award the project. And I'm gonna make a presumption here to include the 5% contingency, which we hope we don't need to get into, but you do need some contingency. Otherwise, we come back every time we have a change order and we delay responding to that. And also include the construction, testing, and engineering cost, minus the gateway feature, no gateway feature. You do want to go with or eliminate the any type of colored, paved, or stamped median, but you do want pavers in lieu of colored stamped concrete for the crosswalks, and you do want to continue to include the street lighting that fills the gap between 4th Street and Front Street.
Mm-hmm. As I recall. Yeah.
And we're going to come up with a basic cost here, but it'd probably be a little less because we're removing the median.
Yeah, the gateway feature, let's see, you have 2.868. You will eliminate the colored concrete median and street signs. That's minus $44,355.12.
Okay. I apologize for not asking this sooner, but what are the street signs portion of that color?
We have median? We have a budget every year where we replace street signs anyway with our guys, and so it would be not a huge deal. And this is the first project we ever actually bid that out. We typically, as a staff, East Magnolia, South Ohio, 9th Street, any projects we've done in the past, our guys do all the signings. It's just fairly efficient for them to do that, and we actually have a budget starting last year with making sure they go to the HIP grade. I don't know if you remember that discussion,
right,
but we're trying to go to this certain grade. Well, so that's where we're headed with signing, and we have a budget to do that, and we don't necessarily have these signs or this area of town picked anyway, so we could easily get this area with a larger area to replace the signs, as well as reusing signs that we've already replaced over the years or have replaced with HIP signs. So we felt like that was an easy $25,000 savings that we could utilize here. So that's why we put that in with the colored concrete portion,
okay,
where we could reduce that portion as well.
Dan, if you need more time to make sure you get the number right, we can table this and then bring it back later
Let's
in the agenda,
that.
And then that way we'll have the exact number.
So I'm removing, just to make sure, I'll go calculate it, $44,355.12. I'll remove that, and I'll remove the $70,000 gateway feature. But we'll make sure we put in the bricks and not the colored concrete.
Mm-hmm.
The 5% contingency and the testing.
And the segment.
And we're adding the clay bricks.
Right. Clay bricks, right.
Yeah,
and we are removing the signs, is that correct? Or?
Yeah.
Correct.
That's what I understand it, yeah. Okay. Okay, table it for now and I'll go calculate and I'll be back.
Great.
Thank you.
Okay.
Well, Mr. Mayor, I would...
I'm sorry, real quick. You have lighting in there, don't you?
Yeah, I left the lighting
yeah,
in.
Okay. Just want to make sure.
I'm glad.
Okay,
that's you. A little sorry. Easier on the project to get that all done at the same time. I feel like that's a good idea. Thank you.
Okay. Let me just real quick. Is there anyone else from the public at all who had anything? Okay. Then we'll bring it back.
All right. Then, Mr. Mayor, I would move that we place item 7, agenda section 7, item 4 on the table.
Second.
Motion is second to hold item 7-4 and table it until later in the meeting. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? That motion carries 5-0. That item will address later in the meeting. That will take us on to development business. That's all right. We're jumping around.
Item 8.1, first reading ordinance number 15-10769, formalizing the property tax exemption for Veris Technologies' new facility located at 1925 Clay Ridge Court.
Mr. Andrew.
Thank you, Mayor and Commissioners. Back in November of 2013, the City Commission approved a resolution stating your intent to authorize a property tax exemption for a proposed new manufacturing facility that was going out on what was then Vortex Avenue, which is now, as you see in your report, Clay Ridge Court. The request came from Veris Technologies, who was operating in shared space with GeoProbe Systems up on North Broadway, and they desired to have their own freestanding facility for their soil mapping equipment, both design and construction. And so they purchased 8.55 acres on Vortex Avenue from the Salina Airport Authority, constructed a new facility that's approximately 9,600 square feet with both office space and manufacturing space for the manufacture of their soil probe machines. And the policy that you have in place allows 18 months to complete a project, and they completed this in November 2014. They've had all their inspections and a final certificate of occupancy. They have submitted their reports on capital investment and number of jobs created, and this is back for your consideration for formalizing the final result. And so you can see at the bottom of the report there, when they submitted their application, they projected they would spend a little over $1.2 million and create 3 new jobs. The actual was closer to $1.4 million and 2 new jobs. And the formula that the city has had in place for some time on property tax exemptions puts a greater weight on job creation than it does on capital investment. And so with the creation of 2 new jobs under the formula, they would be eligible for a partial exemption that would be 41% for years 1 through 5 and 20.5% for years 6 through 10. That would apply to the building only, not to the underlying land. And that exemption would apply to all the taxing districts. As we noted, this subdivision has the oddity of being inside the Southeast of Saline school district boundary, so that school district would be affected by the exemption and not USD 305. There were no comments received from any of the affected taxing jurisdictions at the time, and the appropriate action today would be to formalize the tax exemption by adopting the attached ordinance. Did note that at the start of the process, we are at 1925 Vortex Avenue, and we're now 1925 Clay Ridge Court. We do have Larry Kerr here from Veris Technologies if you have particular questions about their business operation, and I believe Tim Rogers is also here if you have questions about the transaction and the development that occurred there.
Okay, any questions for staff?
Staff, no.
Mr. Okay. Kerr.
Thank you.
Okay. Maybe the applicant, I think we may have a question for, I think maybe Commissioner Davis might have it if Mr. Kerr is here. Yeah.
Larry Kerr, one of the partners of Veris Technologies.
Simple question, actually. Okay. Is it anticipated that as a result of this, more than 2 jobs would be created over the next few years?
Yeah, we would anticipate there'd be more. The current commodity prices had an impact on what we're doing. That doesn't stop us from doing things, but that's been the impact there. So we would expect there to be continued increase in employment.
Okay. Hate to drag you all the way up, but that was the only question.
Okay. Glad to answer it. Great. Appreciate your consideration.
Well, hey, make it worth your trip up there.
Okay.
I think a couple of us were able to go to an open house that you guys had out there, and Eric and Paul showed us around. And
right.
And it's a really nice facility. What you guys are doing is really interesting, and I think with our community, I think setting itself apart from others in precision agriculture, I think that it will hopefully spawn other like businesses to perhaps locate to the community. And so we thank you guys for
appreciate you coming out to look at it. And we've already noticed that the customers that come in from other states or around the world, we got a Brazil contact and otherwise, they appreciate the look of the building. You know, it presents itself well for the company as well as the community.
Yeah. You don't think they would have been more improved with Veris Court instead?
Well,
Clay Ridge Court's good.
Too much confusion.
Yeah.
You want to call it Householder.
Yeah, well, I still want Householder Way, but Householder's Way, Aaron's Way, I'll take either one. But yeah,
find a street somewhere, you can do it.
Yeah, build a street is all it takes. So, yeah. Okay, well, appreciate it. Thank you. Okay, anyone from the public here to comment on this issue at all? Okay, seeing none, I bring it back to the commission for possible action.
Mr. Mayor, I move that we approve on first reading ordinance number 15-10769, formalizing the property tax exemption for Veris Technologies new facility located at 1925 Clay Ridge Court.
Second.
Motion is second to adopt ordinance number 15-10769. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? That motion carries 5-0.
Item 8.2, application Z15-1, requesting an amendment of the list of permitted uses in section 42-317 of the C5 district regulations in Article 6, Division 14 of the zoning ordinance. Item 8.1A, first reading ordinance number 15-10770. 8.2B, declare a compelling public interest exists to allow first and second reading on the same day at the discretion of the governing body. Item 8.2C, second reading ordinance number 15-10770 at the discretion of the governing body.
Great, Mr. Andrew.
Thank you, Mayor and Commissioners. My analogy would be that our C5 district regulations are a leaky boat, and we'd like to patch the hole as quickly as is prudent. We have created in 1977 our primary commercial districts, which are C3 shopping center, C5 service commercial, and C6 heavy commercial. And while we don't have a purely pyramidal zoning scheme, we do have a cumulative zoning scheme, which would mean that you have a C1 district, the C2 would be less restrictive than it, the C3 would be less restrictive than C2, and C5 would be less restrictive than C3. But if you, in our research going back to 1977, there were 42 uses listed in C5. There were 59 uses listed in C3. The way you would normally design an ordinance is that there would be more allowed in C5 than C3, and then you see that in C6 it jumped to 90. And there was some catch-all language about any other similar uses not specifically listed are permitted. And so there was an attempt in our research in 1986. The Planning Commission asked the planning staff to patch the hole in the C5 boat, and they did enact a text amendment. But what we found was that they increased the number of uses from 42 to 62, but they still left 15 unaccounted for. So we did another cross check, and on page 2 there we listed 15 uses that are specifically listed in C3 that are, for reasons unknown to us, omitted in C5. Some of those are not perfectly worded. Some of them are antiquated. But as we discussed with the Planning Commission, this is basically a patch or a quick fix to fill in the omissions. And there will be a time another day that we will look with the Planning Commission and City Commission at out-of-date, irrelevant uses. And most people don't refer to Genesis as a reducing salon anymore, but that's the terminology that's in there currently. And the other thing that was notable is that medical and dental clinics are permitted in every commercial district, except for some reason, the C5 list. So we shared this with the Planning Commission. They initiated a text amendment on the approach to insert the missing uses. Staff certainly recognizes as long-term a better solution might be to have groups of uses such as personal services or a broad retail categories and things like that, rather than trying to list every use individually. Another approach would be to have a matrix that would be attached as an appendix to the ordinance, and you would spend your time in looking at the matrix instead of amending each of the individual sections. But short term, we think this insertion of the 15 missing uses is a necessary plugging of that hole. The Planning Commission they started to have some substantive discussions, but realized that what they needed to do was just recommend approval of adding the 15 uses, and then we will come back and revisit all the commercial districts and the antiquated nature of some of the listed uses. And so our recommendation would be to approve the ordinance that you have before you, which adds in the 15 identified uses. Those should be hopefully highlighted in red in the ordinance that you have attached to indicate the 15 that would be added. And because we are out administering, making decisions on uses in the C5 district, and we do have a pending building permit application now, we would request that you give some consideration to declaring that a compelling public interest exists to allow second reading of this on today's agenda. So with that, I'd be happy to address any questions for you.
Any questions for staff on this? Okay.
Thank you.
Anyone from the public care to discuss anything in this? Okay, seeing none, I bring it back to the commission for possible action.
Mr. Mayor, move adoption in first reading. Ordinance number 15-10770, adding 15 identified uses to the C5 permitted uses list in section 42-317.
Motion and second on ordinance to approve ordinance number 15-10770. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? That motion carries 5-0.
Mr. Mayor, I move that a compelling public interest is present in order to order a second reading on this motion today.
Second.
Motion and second to declare a compelling public interest exists to follow second reading on today. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? That motion carries 5-0.
Mr. Mayor, I move that we approve on second reading ordinance number 15-10770, adding 15 identified uses to the C5 permitted uses list in section 42-317.
Second.
Motion and second to approve on second reading ordinance number 15-10770. If the clerk would call the roll, please.
Commissioner Blanchard.
Aye.
Commissioner Crawford.
Aye.
Commissioner Davis.
Aye.
Commissioner Hardy.
Aye.
Mayor Householder.
Aye. That motion carries 5-0.
Item 8.3, resolution number 15-7198, authorizing certain building improvements at the former Dell's Electronics store at 2770 South 9th Street to encroach into a public utility easement.
Mr. Andrew.
This item comes to you from a request resulting from a pending purchase of a property out on South 9th Street. If you're familiar with the former Adele's Electronics store at 2770 South 9th, that store recently closed and is vacant. And MedExpress, which is an urgent care type clinic, has expressed interest in purchasing that property and developing it as a MedExpress location. And as part of their acquisition, they had an Alta survey done of the property, and that Alta survey identified two minor building encroachments into an adjoining public utility easement that runs along the north boundary of the lot. The encroachments are roughly half a foot in nature, and it appears that it was done at a time when extra metal siding was applied to the building following its initial construction. There are also some downspouts and below ground footings that extend into that easement area as well. It's staff understanding that the air conditioner compressors that showed on the survey will be relocated out of the easement over to the west side of the building. There was kind of an addition put onto the west side that Dell's used to install audio equipment and vehicles, and the plan is to remove that portion of the building, which will actually reduce the size of the building somewhat and allow a space for those compressors to be relocated. We have had an ordinance in place since the 1990s that prohibits the placement or construction of buildings in a public easement unless expressly authorized by the Board of Commissioners. So we were contacted about creating some sort of easement encroachment agreement, and as the request was reviewed by the city attorney's office, they believe that the resolution being adopted pursuant to the written authorization allowed in section 4263A is the most appropriate method of authorizing those encroachments. There is a public water line and there's a public sewer line north of that building. But Ms. Tasker has looked at both of those, and she finds the encroachments to be minor and not impacting our ability to maintain those lines. In the perception of the title company, it does affect their ability to make a clean title opinion on this property, and that's why this application is before you today. So you have a draft stamp on the resolution, and the purpose for that is that when this went out, I did not have written confirmation that the air conditioner compressors are going to be relocated, and with that confirmation, the final version of this that the mayor would execute, if you would approve it, would delete the reference to air conditioner compressors. And so that is the reason for the draft stamp, because we weren't sure whether the resolution would incorporate those or not, but I have confirmed that they will be relocated. So we're primarily looking at metal siding and downspouts and below ground portions of footings in the easement area. So your options would be to approve the attached resolution authorizing the building encroachments to remain as is. You could postpone consideration if you need additional information to reach a decision, or if you want staff to modify the resolution, or you could decline to approve the attached resolution and provide further direction to staff and MedExpress. But this is apparently is holding up the closing on the transaction, and so this item was placed on your agenda today.
Okay. Any questions for staff on this at all?
How do footing encroachments come to pass?
It may vary on the level of detail of the plans. It also may vary on the if they don't show clearly on the plans, or also may vary with the scrutiny that is applied at the plan review stage. Sometimes the extent of the footings is not always noted on a site plan or survey. So anytime that you have a building that is where essentially the wall is snugged right up to the easement line. More scrutiny needs to be looked at in terms of what might be north of the wall of the building. So it, we're, most people are very vigilant on terms of actual occupancy of space by the building, but footings and things like downspouts don't always clearly show up on the drawings.
Mm-hmm. Those footings, I mean, downspouts are something that are pretty
easily moved.
Easy to move. Footings are there forever. So would that be fall in the responsibility of an inspector, or would that?
It would probably more fall under the time of the plan review that the building was constructed to make, because that's the point at which a building could be shifted or moved in order to avoid that. Mm-hmm. But I believe that is what took place here, is that the building sidewall was snugged up right next to the utility line and didn't show any apparent encroachments, but it turned out that as it was built, there were some encroachments into that easement.
Would you consider this to then to be an exception and not a rule?
This would be an exception, not a rule, and the goal would be to identify it and keep it from happening in the first place.
Okay, any other questions for staff? All right, thank you, Mr. Andrew. Anyone from the public care to comment on this matter at all? Okay. All right. I'll bring it back to the commission for possible action.
I move we approve resolution number 15-7198, authorizing certain building improvements at the former Dale's Electronic Store at 2770 South 9th Street to encroach into public utility easement.
Second.
Motion and second to approve resolution number 15-7198. Any further discussion?
Excuse me, Mayor, if I may.
Yes, sir.
Just to be sure, am I correct, Mr. Andrew, that we anticipated that the motion would reflect the modification to the resolution?
Yeah, that the resolution would be modified to delete the reference to air conditioner compressors.
If that works for the movement and the second, that the record can reflect that.
Oh, I'm sorry. Your initial motion is to include that removal, that will be moved around to the, I saw that back somewhere.
Yeah, my concern was that the document before you still includes that language, and just to be absolutely sure for everybody concerned that if the intent was to remove it, as Mr. Andrew had suggested, that the motion indicate that was your wish.
Okay. Is that square with your motion on there? Okay. And your second?
And the second.
Yeah. Okay. So motion and second to include that air conditioning provision be attached. Is that still fine with everybody? No further discussion? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? That motion carries 5-0. So,
Mayor, can I get 2 minutes, please, or three?
You can, because I was thinking the compelling public interest was a break. So let's break for a couple of minutes, and we'll come back. Okay, we'll bring us back in session a little longer than 2 minutes, but.
All right, Mr. Mayor, I move that we place item 7-4, awarding the project to reconstruct Iron Avenue from Front Street to Delaware Avenue, city project number 13-3008, and place it on the table.
Second.
Oh, I'm sorry, remove it from the table.
Remove from the table.
Second.
Okay, I didn't know we need a motion. I thought we could just bring it back. Do we still need a motion to bring it back in? All right. Well, there you go. Any further discussion? We want to hold this for a little longer. This could potentially be my last action, spending $3 million. And so
there's still next.
I know
week.
There's next week, but I don't know. I haven't seen.
Commissioners, what we'll have for you are really two actions. One will deal with the actual bid award, and the other will deal with the amended budget and the use of the contingency, authorizing staff to utilize that for change orders. So that way, we can cover both of those in two separate motions because they really shouldn't mix. And so Dan will go ahead and go
okay.
over that with you.
So got a motion and a second to bring this off the table and bring it back on before the commission. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? And that's back on the table. Mr. Stack, you've got some new numbers for us.
I do. I was able to recalculate when you remove the median. The brick cost is a little bit more, so then that removes a little more dollars. And so at the end of the, and then the moving the signing, like we talked about, we are at a $3,172,686.14.
Does that include the contingency?
It does not. Well, that'll be a separate motion.
Okay.
Yeah, Commissioners, rather than put the contingency in the approval of the bid piece, the contingency will be the motion that will address the revised project budget, then we'll have the ability with the motion to utilize the contingency for the change orders.
Okay, based on a percentage versus a true number, then you say, okay.
Yeah.
Just ask one question. With the revision, does that change the way the final bids of the three bidders would end up? Would that change the award of the contract, any of the? I didn't know if the items that were removed were
right.
bidded differently.
Right, they are somewhat. It doesn't change who the winner is. We have the ability to remove up to 25% of the contract from the contractor without even renegotiating prices from them. So that's kind of one of our, in our instructions to bidders or our contract language, that's the contractors understand that, you know, we could just remove 25% if we really wanted to. So in this case, we're not removing.
Okay,
too much, really. We're removing, like we said, the median and the signs, and they understood that.
Okay, thank you.
Did the city establish the working schedule as well?
We did. It's a year-long project. We did try to put three months on the part in between by the school, and that received very bad reviews from the contractors, so we were just not able. We felt like we had to remove that, basically. They said, we'll work as hard as we can to get that done, but they said there's no way we could get that done in time for school to be ready. So that helped us kind of understand, okay, our interest in getting it done this year, we maybe could have done it, but it would have cost us more. So why we went with the schedule into next year.
Would the noisy, earth-shattering part near the school be done by second week in August?
I believe so. Yeah, the removals, the water lines, those are the things that'll be, the majority of that'll be done. Paving isn't quite as loud, I guess. I'd like to say that. Trucks, those darn concrete trucks might be a little bit loud, but yeah, that's,
would have to nothing think. Like ripping up the streets.
Right, right.
Yeah, right.
The removals, those are usually the roughest part.
Okay, no other questions?
Well, I got a quick question. If we're looking for two different motions, are we looking for a revised project budget first?
Yeah, that's probably best.
Okay, and then the second would be a budget plus a contingency? Or what would the second
revised one? The second will actually be the award to the contractor with the pieces of the project that are under the contractor's authority. And those pieces would be, of course, the roadway, as presented, the roadway project, including the water line replacement, including the street lighting, and including the change of pavers for the crosswalks in lieu of colored concrete. I believe those are the physical changes, aren't they, Dan?
Mm-hmm.
And in the amount that Dan had just mentioned, you can say that again and they can fill that in, because I didn't write it down.
Signs as well.
Yeah, that's right. I missed the elimination, which is the exclusion of the colored median and signs.
Do you want the total budget first?
Well, the budget for that, the award, at this point, the contractor.
Well, I'll tell you what, let me.
Number for the contractor, and then
contractor
they can come back to the motion for the other.
Let me go ahead and peel off number part A of this thing, and maybe once we peel off part A, we can get to part B. So, Mr. Mayor, I move that we approve a revised project budget of $3,172,686.14 for city project number 13-3008, the Iron Avenue reconstruction from Front Street to Delaware Avenue.
Second. Well,
Commissioners, before you move forward on that, that number is the net number for the contractor. What the motion on the budget is going to include, in addition of the 5% contingency, it's going to include the addition of the concrete testing and engineering.
That number is $3.356 million. So
right.
I can give you that if right. You'd rather put that in there, or you want to award it to the
contractor. The budget
first.
Itself is going to be a little bigger than the award to the contractor because you have the contingency and the testing in that piece of it. So that's why
okay.
They're two separate items.
So the first item, we're not doing a revised budget. We're doing.
We can do a revised budget, and so let me.
But I mean that's not what the 3.172 is.
Correct.
No,
that number was the net
number.
To the contractor
right.
For the award of bid.
That's okay. The award of bid to the contractor.
Gonna
I apologize switching those back and forth and getting you out of order.
Yeah.
I didn't mean to do that.
Okay, new paper here. Mr. Mayor, I'll withdraw that motion.
Okay. And so let me go ahead and state the changes, and I'll Dan fill in the number again.
Okay.
But for the budget, you had authorized a revised project budget that includes the project as presented to include the concrete testing and engineering, the 5% contingency, the waterline replacement, the street lighting between 4th and Front Street, the use of pavers instead of the colored concrete for crosswalks, the elimination of the gateway feature, and the elimination of the colored median and signs in the amount of
$3,356,320.45.
And then authorize staff to address any change orders that occur within the 5% contingency. And if you wanted to say so moved, I'm sure
so
Shandy's
moved.
Got the magic there.
There you go.
Second.
So we got a motion and a second for a real long motion that I'm sure the clerk has, but I don't have in front of me. But I think we got the spirit of it. Any further discussion on that?
Just a quick question. That does include the 5% contingency.
Does.
Yes.
Okay.
That's the whole project there.
Yep.
The whole enchilada.
Mm.
Sorry.
Commissioner Davis.
Commissioner Davis,
sorry.
I second.
I heard a slight.
Yeah. It was a second on my part.
Okay. No further discussion of that? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? That motion carries 5-0 on the first part.
And then when you make the motion for the award of bid, I think it would be important to include that, to address that it does include the water line replacement, because that's in the bid, the street lighting between 4th and Front, because that's in the bid, the use of pavers instead of the colored concrete for the crosswalks, and the elimination of the colored median and signs in the amount of, you got the 3 point, what is it, Dan?
3,172,686.14.
To pavers as the low bidder.
Okay. So moved.
I knew that was coming.
Second.
Motion is second. For part B of this ordinance, to finish out the awarding of the contract to pavers, is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
In the amount of, I'll go ahead and throw that in there, I
got it right here. $3,172,686.14.
Exactly. Any further discussion on that? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? That motion carries 5-0. Big numbers. Hard to keep it all straight.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It's going to be a big project. I know you guys are busy.
It's going to be a big project.
Have
fun. Thank you for your patience as we work.
Well, thank you for all the options, because I think,
yeah,
you know, up to the end. We're working through kind of, I think, what we, a budget that we can live with and some of the long-term consequences, so.
Yeah, and commissioners, this is, when people see this project, they will be surprised because a lot of folks wouldn't have probably surprisingly watched your meetings and understand the scope,
right.
But it's going to be a beautiful project. It's going to be very, very functional with regards to, again, bicycles, hike bike, and so forth with the trail. It's going to be the lighting and so forth and the amenities and the color at the intersections. But one of the beautiful parts of this is that one of the goals that you've had and prior commissions have had is to increase, call it the multimodal. We've got the buses, we've got vehicles, and we have the hike bike paths. And this hike bike, this will be that, have that hike bike path. I believe it's 8 feet, but because we can't fit in 10, but it'll have that from the core of our downtown all the way out to Delaware, and then eventually,
right.
When that all goes all the way up to Marymount, you're going to connect the whole eastern part of town with the core where people can feel really comfortable riding off the roadway with their family. And I think that's going to change how people think about traveling to downtown. I think that's a big deal for us.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
But then again, we don't do anything for downtown. I mean, it's
little
all,
thing
all private investors.
Right. Well, and the only thing you'll have to add is a moving sidewalk to get people up the hill. At least us older
that
ones.
That last getting home part is
I wish we could do that between the Bicentennial Center through Oakdale Park and the downtown, quite honestly.
That would be really good, yeah.
I say an increased use of Segways.
That's
in
right.
The future.
That's right. Okay, any other business?
I just wanted to say something.
Oh, 1 second, yeah. Okay. Sure, why don't you come up? Sorry, we had the public section, but that's fine, you're here.
I'm sorry, I didn't step up then.
Oh, no, by, yeah.
But
we usually only let Ray Haruska stand up at this time in the meeting, but it's okay, you can go ahead.
This is no big $1 million project, I don't think, but I would like you to consider slowing the traffic down on Iron Street.
Oh.
At least to 9th Street.
And just sorry, if you could, just for the record, your name and address, please.
I'm
sorry.
Carla Mahon, and I have a business at 119 East Iron.
Oh, okay, great.
And there's only parallel parking in that area, and you have 40-mile-an-hour traffic going through there, so trying to get parallel parked between two cars sometimes is almost just hazardous.
Yeah, so should be 30,
well,
but they probably do 40. Yeah.
I think if you want to take that, I think that this project will help that a little bit.
Well, that's a good question, Commissioner. Santa Fe, which of course is your north-south arterial through downtown, has a reduced speed limit of 20 from the north and south, but the cross streets are 30. Again, yeah, what speed the cars travel can vary from
right.
the time of day, but they're 30. So it does probably make sense to look at if this downtown project can move forward to look at those speed limits as well, because I've always thought to myself it's a little odd to be going 20 north and south and 30 plus east and west.
Yeah.
And part of that is because I think they wanted to slow down the movement on Santa Fe because of the angled parking where you have a little difficulty seeing. They try to eliminate rear-end type accidents, but it's still different to think of two speed limits in the same area just because you're going a different direction.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So that's something that we could definitely look at as part of that project.
Yeah.
Well, and something to bear in mind is that you had said from 9th Street to
I'm just guessing, yeah.
Well,
I'm just worried about my own little area.
Well, what's nice about this is when you have the bike lanes on the street, that the road narrows a little bit, which helps to reduce the traffic speeds.
Okay.
And so as we look, and I don't know, Dan, if we have bike lanes proposed to be painted on that section of Iron as it goes through downtown.
Yes.
But but as those things happen, those things tend to be traffic calming devices.
Okay.
So, well.
Well, yeah, and when you think about not knowing what a final design would be on Santa Fe, there's no question if it's narrowed some, that'll be traffic. And so there is a transition on the side streets. The question is how far in the final scope of a project does it transition or can it transition,
mm-hmm.
Especially when we think about making sure we have bike lanes that go clear through. And I definitely think that makes a lot of sense because
right.
it wouldn't make
yeah.
sense to stop them before you get to the heart of downtown. So those types of features will likely be there and will help with that. And at the same time, like I said, we can certainly look at the speed limit as well.
and our aim is to make downtown and some of the core neighborhoods more bicycle and pedestrian friendly.
All right.
So definitely comes in into play because it's you're probably right, 30 with all the new activity and people on foot down there's probably getting a little fast for that downtown core probably was empty in the 80s and 90s.
We've had several accidents just in the last couple of months.
As well. And you have the coffee, the roaster.
On the roaster.
The roaster. Okay, that's what I thought. Yeah, that's what I thought it was. Great, great.
From a timing perspective, just the reality of it is that when you look at the downtown project, again, we have to lock in the field house first and establish the district, which may happen, say, around 6 weeks or so, 6 or 7 weeks. And then after that, the project plan has to be submitted and approved to the Department of Commerce within a year. And then once you have a project plan, if the projects line up, the increment's there to do that type of project, you're probably looking at least a year for the design of such a project, because you're talking a pretty massive design, maybe longer than a year. And I'm gonna guess between a year, 2 years, probably closer to 2 years for construction. So the reality of when you actually have all of what we just talked about in place could easily be 3 years, 3 to 4 years from now. So if you want to look at the speed limit before then, you've got some time in there. It's not gonna this stuff won't happen overnight, even if it does happen. So that's a question for you, is if you want staff to look at the cross traffic speed limit, at least on Iron Street, which is clearly an arterial through town, prior to that time. We can certainly do that. they can put the traffic stuff out there. They can kind of see what the 85th percentile is. You can decide if you want to slow it or not, but we can get you back some data that might be helpful for you if you like it.
I think it makes sense. It'd be nice to know that, I mean, cars probably are doing 40 through there. So at least be nice to know kind of what our speed average is going on there, and if it's really just an enforcement thing that people are going a little fast, or if 20 really is needed.
Well, if you're comfortable, we can do some monitoring there, and we can maybe put together some type of report and bring it back to you at some point, and you can decide if you want to do anything further.
Sure. Okay. Makes sense.
Does that work? Is that Dan?
Yep. All right. Thanks, everybody.
Okay, great. Thank you for your input. Yeah.
It pays to come.
That's right. That's right. Yeah. That's
you get
right.
Action.
Yeah. Okay, so any other action you say you need?
I just wanted to say a couple of things that I was just disappointed in not in the way the election went, because of the flipping of the coin for either between Randy Hardy or Joe Hay. I mean, both of those men are men of good character. I mean, good men, but for a city of 50,000 population, it just seems to me like it's kind of rinky-dink to flip a coin, and there must be some way there. Could be the county commission could look into that, or whoever is responsible for that. I know Merriman has to follow his guidelines, but you know, you really work hard for these kinds of elections, and we have a good community. There's been a lot of I think discourse and so forth in the election. I just would hope that we get away from flipping a coin in the future and get to something it just seems below our standards.
Yeah, commissioners, we're assuming that may be a state law provision for a tie. We can ask the question for you and check and see if there's any discretion to change that. Not sure what it would be. I suggested arm wrestling if you wanted to, you know, up the class of how they do that. But no, we can see what options are out there. Other states have had to deal with it at different times, believe it or not. My town that I grew up in had a tie. I don't know what they do in Missouri. I don't want to ask. But so they have a protocol, and I don't know what it is, but is it flipping a coin, or is it a
duel.
Random number? Is it picking a number out of a hat? I don't know, but
I'm all for a duel with you.
So we'll take a look and get some information back.
I'll put you out there on the line.
All right. I have a little bit of other business if we're still in other business.
Sure.
I'm going to put somebody on the spot, and that's going to be Martha Gebhardt.
Uh-oh.
She's sitting in the back there. And I just want to tell you that I've certainly appreciated serving with your son, Aaron. And I know you're not going to be here next week at the changing of the guard. And I also know that it's really difficult to have your son sit up here and be criticized and also praised. But I think that would probably be a very hard thing to do. And it's been my experience that you've done that with a lot of grace, and you always have a smile on your face, and I appreciate that and the kind word that you have to say to me and the other commissioners. I know I appreciate that. And so thank you. Enjoy your trip with your sisters next week. And hopefully we'll see Jack here next week at the changing of the guard, but thank you for what you've done over the past 4 years as a family member.
Great. I agree. Yeah.
And also, Commissioner Hardy, we're gonna hope that your recount is successful. So, We'll wait till next week with you.
We'll know when that is. That's right.
Let's just drag this out as long as we can.
You drag it out next week. I'm in vacation mode. So, okay. It's just weird getting out of here so early. This feels so strange. It's like we're before 6 o'clock. Yeah.
More importantly, no executive session.
No executive session.
Well, then I'll make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
Motion is second to adjourn. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? That we are adjourned.